a man in the horror movies we all tell, who stalks these nights on the late, late shelf.
Hey folks, Kilt-Man here, Kilt-Man! At your services, I brought some friends along because we've got some news, some movie news. Oh yeah, what might that be? What might that be? What kind of movie news might inspire me to bring these guys for Wolfman, Frankenstein's monster, and Michael Myers, but not just any old Michael Myers, the Michael Myers from the Rob Zombie stable. What could it be? What could it be? Okay, here's a big clue. The Munsters! Yes! Everyone's favourite comical monster family from the 60s. Mid-American 60s sitcom style. And they brought in the Munsters. The idea came right off the back of Charles Adams and the Adams family. Which, you were kind of in two camps really, weren't you? Adams family or Munsters? Because Munsters started just after in the first couple episodes of The Addams Family. Now, as a kid, I always preferred The Munsters because A, it was funnier. It was just funnier. And it had my favourite monsters, of course, because I'm a Universal Monsters devotee and disciple. So I was obviously going to affiliate myself with that. But I liked The Addams Family, you know, Cousin It, Lurch, Thing. Yeah, it was great. You know, I still love it now. But that's definitely more subversive, more satirical, whereas The Munsters is more accessible. It's less quirky, it's more obvious. But just beneath that nice veneer of the lovely monster family who are just having normal sitcom dramas and dilemmas, you've actually got quite a clever sort of twist on what was the modern American family, the nuclear family and all that, because they were monsters, but they just did normal things. They were a normal, loving family, and yet all the neighbors and everybody else who came into contact with them shunned them, were terrified of them. And the ripple effect of that, the political sort of effect of that, has gone across the ages since then, because it is just, you know, a minority family living in a predominantly white society. So that's where the great sort of the underbelly of the Munsters really lies. And the Munsters came about in the 1940s, believe it or not. Universal were approached by a couple of writers who said that the idea of let's do an animated show of a monster family. So you can bring in Wolfman, you can bring in vampires, you can bring in Dracula and vampire vixens and werewolves and Frankenstein's monster. You can bring all that in. And it'd be great. It'd be like a pastiche, a parody of, you know, just modern America. But Universal went, no, we ain't doing that. Because, and the reason why they said no initially was because animated, look, if you want to do animated shows, go to Disney, because Disney will do it. We don't really do that sort of thing. So it's a great idea, but we don't do animated shows. So it then sort of sat on the shelf and gestated for a bit. And then two other writers and creators came in and said, okay, let's do this as a live action show. Let's do it as a sort of like a spoof of all, you know, the sitcom stuff that's going on. This is in the 60s now. So we've gone 20 years beyond the initial, you know, idea and spark, you see what I did there? And then was born The Munsters in 1964. And Frank Gwynne played Herman Munster, Al Lewis played Grandpa, who is a Transylvanian vampire count. Yvonne de Carlo, of course, is Lilly Munster. Oh my god, even as a kid, I thought I'd died and gone to some kind of universal tinted nirvana. I've said before many, many times on this channel how much I adore goth girls. Yvonne de Carlo, yes, older woman, oh my god, so supremely sexy, infinitely sexier and more desirable and funnier and more warm and human than Morticia in the Addams Family.
Anyway. Of course, in the initial pilot episode, there was a lot of different cast. You have the beautiful girl, because obviously you've got Butch. What's he called? The little werewolf lad. Oh, I've forgotten his name now. Eddie, played by Butch Patrick. But initially, it was someone else playing the little werewolf lad. And it was someone else playing Marilyn, who's the niece, who is just normal, blonde, gorgeous. But initially, the girl looked too much like Marilyn Monroe. So after the pilot episode, which was successful, Universal said, hang on a minute, can we just change the dynamic a little bit here? So in came Butch Patrick as Eddie the werewolf boy, and a different girl playing Marilyn. But also, they'd had someone else playing the Lilly Munster character, so they brought in Yvonne de Carlo, and she was a proper big actress. She'd been in the Ten Commandments, for God's sake. Holy Moses. And people say I script these. But Al Lewis, who plays the grandpa, he and Fred Gwynn have both been in a great successful comedy TV show called Car 57, Where Are You? Playing two police coppers in a car. And so that their chemistry was already set. But apparently Al Lewis said, like, well, you know, this kind of show doesn't need someone of proper Hollywood gold standard Yvonne de Carlo. But de Carlo came in, vamped herself up, and just dominated. Her warmth and her chemistry with all of them is just, she appears on screen and I melt. Simple as. She is adorable. God rest their soul. And anyway, so yeah, it ran for 2 seasons. It was only destroyed when the Adam West Batman came out. And the Adam West Batman, when that came out, destroyed every other TV show. So, I think it's Butch Patrick, who played Eddie, who actually said, well, what, you know, they said, well, what stopped the show? So we can't compete with Batman. Simple as. But of course, time has been very, very kind to the Munsters and the Addams family. The Munsters, the original cast, made 2 movies. Munsters Go Home, where they came to England. Well, yeah, the setting was England, for an ancestral home. And it's a good movie. And Munsters Revenge, or Revenge of the Munsters. No, it's Munsters Revenge, I think it is. And they're both good movies. It's just the same thing, just on a movie feature length. But the dynamic of this, on the face of it, dysfunctional family is actually very functional. They're all quirky, they're all weird, they're all odd, they're all monsters, apart from Marilyn. But they are. They get on great. And their problems and strife and dilemmas are simply what we all face. And it's like any sitcom. That was the beauty of it. Whereas Adam's family took things to a different level and kept things bubbling with a subversive quality to it, which was a bit more eccentric and a bit more, I don't know, a bit more sophisticated perhaps. So either love that and despise the simplicity on the face of it of the Munsters, or you despise the sophistication of the Addams Family but just bathe in the simplistic glory of the Munsters. I don't know, I love them both, but I prefer the Munsters. So anyway, the Munsters then, of course, destroyed by Batman, as everything else was, then returned in the 90s with the Munsters Today, which was obviously in colour. By the way, the original series was in black and white because, well, they said, well, it's more in keeping with Universal's ethos. The movies that you are taking off are classic runs from the 30s and 40s. They're black and white, so it should be black and white. Yeah, I buy that to a degree. But it was also $10,000 dearer in those days to shoot a 25-minute episode for TV in colour. So, 1313 Mockingbird Lane, which is the address, the original facade of the front of the house, spooky, ooky, completely crazy, gothic mansion. That was a genuine standing set on the Universal backlot. All the insides and interiors were all sound stages, but the exterior was a standing set, and a glorious edifice it is too. So yeah, the 90s version came and lasted for 72 episodes. 72 episodes! Holy shit. But it's not that good. It tries to capture that moment because they've been frozen in time and they wake up in what would be the modern day then. Not really. Doesn't really work. And then, of course, they tried again. Was it NBC tried to do it again in 2012 with 1313 Mockingbird Lane? I think it was just called Mockingbird Lane. And it was meant to be, and they did a pilot episode, a big, all balls out, big budget pilot episode. And then nothing was heard from it from that point onwards. Obviously, it didn't work. It was meant to be a new sort of twist on it. And this is what we're coming to, folks. A twist on the Munsters. How could you do that? Who could possibly put a spin on the Munsters? Why is the Rob Zombie Michael Myers mask sitting there alongside these classics? Why? Why? Because the rumour mill now has put forth some little spittle nuggets of information that apparently Universal and Rob Zombie are collaborating to make a movie of the Munsters. Rob Zombie, House of 1,000 Corpses, Three from Hell, Halloween 1 and 2, Devil's Rejects, Lords of Salem, Rock Band, Complete from Hell. But is it so strange? On the record, and literally on the record, Rob Zombie is a massive, massive fan, a diehard, lifelong fan of the Munsters. Many of his gigs, he will play his own version of the great, Jack Marshall main theme. Sorry, little notes down there, folks. Oh, by the way, speaking of which, let's get on this. Surfer rockabilly, 50s, 60s rock and roll slant. Composed by Marshall, actually had lyrics, this title theme to the Munsters. It had lyrics, but the lyrics apparently didn't really work out so well, so they were ditched. But it is an absolute classic, immortalized, TV main theme. It's awesome. It's awesome. But Rob Zombie does a version of this in his gigs, his live gigs. He's recorded a few. The Munsters also had They had two vehicles. They had the Munster coach with a K, which is a great big hearse, big elaborate hearse, which they drove around in. Herman with his goggles on and his big driver's cap. But they had a dragster as well, called the Dragula. So much players on words, I can't cope, especially with this. And these were all part of the great big merchandise push. The Munsters had a lot of merchandise. They were hugely successful, hence movies, hence revamps, pun intended, and hence this idea of getting it kickstarted again. But Rob Zombie, what's the slant there? He's a big fan, yeah, but he does his trailer trash absolutely alcohol, nicotine, drugs, masturbation, rough sex, grungy, sort of highly polished yet still grindhouse exploitation movies. So he's a big fan, yeah, he's a big fan of the Munsters. But why would they approach him? Universal were going to release or distribute the House of 1,000 Corpses way back in the day, but then they saw what he made and went, forget it, we're out of here. So that ended up being produced and distributed by Lionsgate. And to my knowledge, I think this is the only time that Universal have come calling back to Rob Zombie. If these rumours are true, let me just say right now that this is not confirmed and there are two sort of slants to this. It's been announced that Rob Zombie and Universal are going to do a movie version of the Munsters. He loves it, so that's great. All of his films have had been set around a dysfunctional family unit. They've all been like that, all of them. All of the quirky, oddball, monstrous characters driven to the extreme and directed and filmed to the extreme. But he's still got a basis in a dysfunctional family unit made up of completely crazed, bizarre characters who shouldn't get along together. Who's to say that he's not going to do a proper modern slant, but respectful to what he actually knows and loves? I know what you're going to say. He knows, loves, and grew up with John Carpenter's Halloween. And look what he did to Halloween. Well, you know what, folks? Halloween, his first one, I actually do appreciate for many reasons. I've spoken at length about it in the past, but where it's not a patch on what John Carpenter does. But his version, if you're going to do a remake, a reboot of something, then unless you're going to be slavishly paying complete meticulous attention to what's gone before and just copying it, like Gus Van Sant with his Psycho Redux, which was just the same fucking film, frame by frame, shot by shot. Christ's sake, what was the point of that? So, unless you're going to do that, what's the point? You know, you've got to do something different. So what he did with Halloween and Michael Myers, he made it more realistic. Whether you like it or you don't, he gave it a slant which was enough separated from the original to make it its own beast, its own animal. Just how Michael Myers grew from a little, needy little kid to Tyler Mane, hulking wrestler Tyler Mane. I don't know, but I still like what he did, and I like the final act of the movie, which is the Halloween remake, basically, with extra blood and gore and violence. It was a radical departure from the original enough, but still related enough to make them both different tangents on the same theme. So that could happen with the Munsters. I'm not saying it needs to be nasty, drug-related, with lots of masturbation and rough sex and Sherry Moon. Oh, because there you go, folks. The casting has already been mentioned, and that Sherry Moon Zombie is going to be in there again. And of course, the first voices are saying, "Oh, she can't be playing Lilly Munster." Well, apparently, she won't be playing Lilly Munster if this does go before cameras and does get made. You've got Cassandra Peterson is going to be in there too. Cassandra Peterson, Elvira herself, the ultimate vamp vixen. Who is she going to play then? And I know she's getting on a bit now, but she could still play it. She has all the attributes, and she is still breathtakingly gorgeous. So she could play Lily beyond any shadow of a doubt. Sherry Moon could be the Marilyn character. Now, and he's using a lot of other stable characters as well. This is what I've heard. None of this is confirmed, so it's just conjecture. But hey, there's fun to conjecture, because chances are this actually will happen. I've got a sly feeling it will. If the likes of Eli Roth can make a family movie, Eli Roth, Green Inferno, and oh, Christ, a load of shit films like Cabin Fever. And I have more respect, by far more respect, for Rob Zombie as a creator and, a movie maker, a composer, a writer, a director, than I have for Eli Roth, who I think is pure and utter shite. And yet he did come out with a family-friendly fantasy horror movie, The House with a Clock in Its Walls. So there you go. If he can do it, then Rob Zombie can do it. But, folks, there's another rumour going round. And these only surfaced yesterday, or last night I saw them, that Rob Zombie himself has said that he is not going to do the Munsters unless it's R-rated. Which totally flies in the face of my defence of him just there. Or does it? How are you going to do that? I mean, are you going to really take a family favourite for generations now, a black and white staple of American sitcom cuisine, the Munsters, a genre fantasy horror crossover. You're going to take that and you're going to add in sex and drugs and rock and roll and death and violence. Are you going to do that? Are you going to do that? Well, it wouldn't surprise me if he did. And I think he could do it. One of his great movie stars, movie devotees, sadly now deceased, is Sid Haig. Sid Haig was in the Lon Chaney Jr. classic, infamous, notorious Spider Baby. That, without a doubt, that was a Rob Zombie movie, but made back in the 60s. You know, that, if Rob Zombie had been making movies then, that's what he'd have come up with. Without a doubt, without a doubt. If he made that now, it'd be drenched in gore and viscera and drugs and rock and roll and anal sex. With corpses. So, you know, I'm not surprised how this dynamic is gonna take shape. I can believe Universal are courting him to do it because he's such a devotee and he is dedicated to his art. His vision will be singular. And if he sticks to what they want as well, or their visions are both in cahoots, they're gonna love it. If he's stipulating it's gonna be R-rated, then I'm also on board for that. Because why the hell not? You proved you could do something different with the Halloween franchise and the Halloween Michael Myers character. You proved you could do something different. Whether you like it or loathe it is irrelevant at this juncture in time. Because he proved he could still make something successful enough to warrant a sequel, for God's sake. So, to bring the Munsters into the modern age, it may be blasphemous. It sounds completely ridiculous, you know, in many ways, because they're friggin' monsters. It's hardly the most, you know, conventional of families, and yet that's the twist. They really are conventional. It's just others' appreciation and observation of them, which is completely wrong. And so he brings all that into it, but makes it modern. Still makes it subversive and funny, but brings in some splat, maybe some scat. I don't know about that, but I'm on board for either interpretation. It's also worth noting that if a film of the Banana Splits can come out, which came out a couple of years ago, and I'm going to review it at some point, and it's a hard R-rated horror movie, yeah, the Banana Splits. And this is before Nick Cage and Willy's Wonderland, and it's the exact same idea. The Banana Splits on their TV show, the animatronics that were used in the TV show, get a glitch and become murderous. And when the studio set gets locked down after filming an episode, they hunt down and kill all the guests in a variety of very explicit, gory ways. And that is the Banana Splits movie. How many innocent people are going to just wander the shelves and go, oh, Banana Splits, oh, a blast from the past, a big childish nostalgia kick. Oh, I'll buy that or I'll rent that. Not noticing the 18 certificate that's on it in the UK. Or the R, wherever else. And then sitting down and being confronted by people being bisected, heads coming off, and just lots and lots of gore. Which it is. And I still loved it. I still loved it. Here's the Munsters theme again. So, I think there's room in the world for a great reworking of the original concept. That could work. Definitely could work. Or you go into the extreme realms. That could still work. It'd be a one-way ticket. It'd be just one, and that'd be it. And it would either be immensely successful with a small niche of audience, and it would completely alienate Rob Zombie again, but he's used to that, so why is he going to care? Or it actually brings in a whole new, you know, legion of fans. You don't know. You just don't know. But either way, I love the Munsters. I love them. Personally, my casting for Lilly Munster would be Alison King from Coronation Street. If anyone out there doesn't watch UK soaps, she plays, she's older, she runs a knicker factory and she's dark haired, penciled on eyebrows. She's absolutely gorgeous. She's getting on a bit now, like, but since she came into the show, and she's in a few other TV shows, always looking divinely sexy and very gothic, she would be ideal for Lilly Munster. Oh my God, just put that white streak in her hair. Oh my God, and the Transylvanian ball gown on her. Oh, come on now, she'd be ideal. And Connie, just to sing the praises of Coronation Street again, they've actually got right now a gothic girl in it who's in a storyline. She's a lesbian. Cory, you fucking rule. Lesbian goth girls? Have I died and gone to heaven? So that reminds me. What would Herman Munster look like? It's gonna be a bastardized hybrid of Michael Myers and Boris Karloff, isn't he? It's not going to be, you know, Fred Gwynne when he gets the kiss off Lily in the big opening credits, which is fantastic. Al Lewis as her father, the grandpa, leans in to, you know, give it. They all go off to work, and she goes, puts her cheek out to everyone for a kiss, and he leans in and she goes, and he goes, oh, like that. He's going to put a bite on it. Everyone gets the kiss. Eddie gets the kiss on the head, I think, on his widow's peak. And and then Herman comes up out the trapdoor, off, so we're off to the office, like, gets a kiss and walks off like that. It's so heartwarming and endearing. How can you give it to Rob Zombie? I hope it's true. I really do, because this is going to go either brilliantly or it's going to be horrendously nasty, blasphemous, sacrilegious, and it's going to scar people. But I'm up for both. I am. Whatever he does, it's not going to ruin the original TV show. And by the way, the episode with the little robotic version of Herman is an absolute classic. A classic. I mean, Tim Burton, you can see how Tim Burton took on the Addams Family. You can see why that happened. Was it Tim Burton did it? Was it Tim Burton who did the Addams Family? I don't think it was now. Oh, what am I asking you? These guys are hopeless. They just keep stum. Look at them poker faces. Fire poker face in your case. But was it Tim Burton? No, it wasn't, was it? I've forgotten who it was. But either way, that's the sort of thing that Tim Burton would do. Whereas Tim Burton wouldn't really do the Munsters, because the Munsters is too obvious. It's not quirky, offbeat enough. Just having Universal Monsters there in conventional roles isn't enough, you know, for some people. That's why the sophistication of the Addams Family, you know, had a lot of, you know, brevity and a lot of legs and just completely dominated some of the market. And it's two great feature films out of it as well. Tim Burton or not? Wow, I cannot remember. How many of these have I had? But anyway, folks, let me know what your thoughts on a Rob Zombie incarnation of the Munsters. Let me know what you think. Is it feasible? Would you palate it? Let me know what direction you want to go in. Pure homage, respectful, but with a modern slant. Or go completely off the rails and just subvert the whole thing and make it trailer trash. I don't know. He does play a great version, his version of that main theme. Let's end up with that. Oh, and while I'm here. Not too much. But folks, yeah. You know, there's not a great deal of film news. There's lots of bits and bobs, but there's nothing really to sink our teeth into. I just thought that this would be interesting. It's an interesting enough idea. Whether it actually happens or not, or whether this is still just complete rumours, who knows? The Munsters, they did try to reboot this a while ago again, as I say, with Mockingbird Lane, and it fell on its arse. And I'm sure there was another movie attempt a few years after that, which obviously went nowhere. But clearly, The Munsters is still a great enough, big enough franchise to spend some money and get some people involved. I don't mind Shelley Moon Zombie, I don't mind her, but she cannot play. She cannot play Lily. Purely, don't do it, don't do that. Anyway, folks, I have been and always shall be Kilt-Man. Please, let me know your thoughts on The Munsters Zombified! And I'm going to see you all in a crypt near you soon.